Hello, everybody. I hope that some of you from the first session last week are here today as well. In part one, we looked at TM basics, essentially in terms of how to deal with translation memories when you're interacting with a TM during the translation process as you translate. As a follow-on to that today, we're going to look at a slightly different aspect of translation memories, particularly maintenance of translation memories. I'll explain more precisely what I mean by that in a moment. Just going to give you a few points of housekeeping first, if I can. As Sue said, today's webinar will run for approximately an hour and a half. We aim to finish at about 3:30. There should be about 15 minutes or so for questions at the end. And we ask you to submit your questions through the chat tool and or the Q&A function in WebEx. We're very gratified that so many of you have taken time to watch and listen today, but the numbers do mean that we can't deal with individual difficulties with sound and so forth. So if you are having that kind of difficulty, if you could refresh your screen or maybe log out of WebEx and back in again, hopefully you'll be able to resolve things that way. And as Sue said, if the worst comes to the worst, the recording will be available to you to download at a later date anyway. Okay, so I'm going to crack on with the content then. The agenda then for today is, first of all, specifically about TM maintenance, different ways to keep your translation memories uncluttered, to clean them up and so forth, make sure they're working as efficiently as possible. And then secondly, we're going to look at a feature called Retrofit, which I think is very useful for translators. And this is really, at least one use of it, is to allow you to make changes outside studio, probably in that final review phase when you produce your target document in Word or PowerPoint or whatever it is, and you have a quick look through it in its target format and maybe make some minor changes at that stage, which you then want to import back into Studio without having to replicate them in Studio. So we'll be looking at how to do that retrofit. We'll look at a few apps from the App Store that are related to TM maintenance in particular. And we'll also look at a technology called PerfectMatch that allows you to deal with situations where your client sends you some updated versions of the files that you're currently working on during a translation project. So how to deal with that situation. And finally, we'll briefly mention group share TMs. They come up in the studio interface now and again and have certain advantages. So I'll just briefly discuss those with you at the end. So the first section then is about TM maintenance. I'm going to look at how to browse and search TMs, how to clean up your TMs, declutter them if you like, and edit the content of TMs. So I'm going to switch to Studio now. So when we do maintenance on our translation memories, we usually do it in the translation memories view down here. So you need to click in this view down here. I'm going to open up one of the sample TMs, which will allow me to do some maintenance to show you how all of that works. So I'm going into my sample files folder and selecting this TM here. It opens up like that in a kind of side-by-side editor, but this side-by-side editor is specifically for maintaining the TM. So you're looking inside into the content of the TM here. So last time at the end of the first webinar in the series, we looked at things like searching in the TM. So I can type something in here, for example. Let me type in translation memory, and I can perform search to pull up any segments that contain that string of text in the source or the target. If I choose to search in the target, we're going to do things a few more slightly involved things in this in this session. I'm just going to clear that search there and search again to bring up the full content of the TM. The first thing I'm going to do is show you how to filter on the content of the TM to bring up certain types of content that you might want to examine for various reasons, such as wanting to tidy up your translation memory, or perhaps find out whether there are certain deficiencies in your translation memory, things that you could remove, for example. So I'm going to do a search that involves looking for any segments in the source that contain fewer than 5 characters. And for this, I need to create a filter here. So I'm going to click the plus button here, add filter. And I'm going to give my filter a name, which will be, let's call it fewer than 5 characters. And I'll save the filter there. And then I need to add a condition to make the filter meaningful. So I click add here. And when I drop this list down, you'll see that there are all sorts of options available to you, such as who last modified the unit in the TM, who last used it, when it was modified or used, etc., who created it and when, etc. So if you're a project manager, this can be very useful to you if you want to isolate certain segments. Perhaps somebody on your team has turned out to be a rogue translator and you want to examine the segments that that person last edited or translated, etc. Here I'm going to go to source segment length, and I'm going to choose smaller than, in other words, fewer than in this case, and put in the value of 5 here. This will give me segments that have 1, 2, 3, or 4 characters in the source. So I click OK to create the filter, and I'll just save it there again. And now I can perform the search. So as you can see here, I've got a number of segments in my TM that probably aren't very meaningful. If you look at the source, they all contain 4 or fewer characters. So one way to clean up your translation memory might be to remove these segments. And I realize that this might not be the way you would do this in reality. Perhaps you'd have a careful look through first, but I'm going to show you how to delete all of these segments in one go, and that's with the batch delete tool up here on the ribbon. So I select batch delete, and if you do use batch delete, be careful that you apply a filter, because if you apply no filter, you could well end up deleting the entire content of the TM. And by the same token, if you're doing this kind of activity, particularly if you're deleting things from the TM, it's a good idea to create a backup copy, obviously, and perhaps even do the work on a replica version of the TM rather than the actual thing. So let's choose the filter 5 under 5 characters here, and we're going to delete anything that matches that filter. So let's click finish. And it says it's deleted 68 translation units from my TM. If I close that now, the search will automatically run itself again. So there are no segments now matching that filter, as you can see from the empty screen. Let's take a look at another one. I'll just remove this filter here. I'll just go back to having no filter. And that's how to bring the all of the segments back to the display. So I'll create another filter now then, and this one is going to be for any segments that have never been used. So segments that have been put in the TM but then never accessed since. So let's create a filter here again. Click the Add Filter button, and I'll call this filter, say, Never Used. And I'll add the condition. This time is going to be usage count, and equal to is fine in this case, 0. Click OK. I'll save that filter again, and then I perform the search. These are all of the segments in my TM that have never been used. So I could, if I wanted, I could go and do the same batch delete operation on those as well, presumably after some kind of examination of the segments as, and a decision as to whether they're useful or not. Okay, so that's a couple of examples for you there. I'm going to just to give you another example here. So it can be very useful to, in your translation memory, to look for duplicate segments. So that's segments where there are potential duplicates. So they may turn out to be useful to you. By duplicates, I mean where there's a single source segment content with more than one translations in the memory. So you might remember from last time, if you attended the last webinar, we had this example where you had I am Joe Biden, I may be the next US president, and then Elizabeth Warren saying the same thing. But in Elizabeth Warren's case, we needed a to use the female the feminine genders for US president, and the masculine gender, obviously, in the case of Joe Biden. So we needed two different translations in the German, at least, for this segment, which was useful to us. But sometimes the duplicates may not be useful, and you may wish to delete them. So I can go here to search in potential duplicates only. And if I perform the search, there I get a duplicate come up. I've accidentally shut Studio down there. And let me just open it up again. Just bear with me a second. It won't take more than about 15 seconds to get it back. So when Studio restarts in a second, I'm going to show you how to look for potential duplicates. And the word potential in the naming there means that it's for you to decide whether they're useful or not. Just because there are two translations in the TM doesn't mean that there's anything wrong, obviously. Necessarily, anyway. Okay, so we're back in again. I need to refresh the TM here. Okay, let me go to back to the search in potential duplicates option here. And I perform the search. Okay, so it may be that, for example, this I decide that I want to retain both versions of this duplicate here. You see that the source is the same and the target has two variations. If I decide to keep it, I can use the next page button up here to go to the next one. Maybe that's also acceptable. If I decide to, for example, remove one of these two, I decide I don't want to have either one of them, I can select it and then I mark it for deletion up here on the ribbon. I can either commit the change now to remove it permanently from the TM, or I can keep going through and go to the next page. And the WebEx controls are getting in the way of my access here to the ribbon. So there we go. I've moved to the next one. If I wanted to remove this one as well, I could say select this one for deletion, and then I can keep browsing through all of the duplicates until I'm happy. And when I want to, I can commit the changes. That means accept these deletions. And again, you might remember from last time, there's no way of going back from this. So be careful before you do commit the changes. So yes to commit the pending changes. And there you go. That's dealing with potential duplicates. So let's look at another aspect now. I'll go back to showing the entire TM. If I search for the word, just use the basic search feature here, and I'm going to search for the word features in the target on the basis that, although the target in this translation memory is German, the English word features has been used in some of the segments or some of the units in the TM. So let's see how many there are. There we go, so quite a few. And what I'm going to do now is show you how to replace the word features with a more German sounding equivalent. So I'm going to, for this, I'm going to use the find and replace, or more accurately, the replace function here. It's Control H to bring it up, or click it on the ribbon up here. And when it comes up, and this is what I want to replace features with a capital F, and then replace it with an alternative term, Funktionen, in the target. I've selected a couple of options here, a matching case, because I don't want to have any lowercase f's at the beginning of words, given that this is German, which capitalizes nouns, as you probably know. And I'm also going to use this option here, match whole word, whose effect I'll show you when we see the results. So first I'm going to find next, and then once I've identified one instance, I can do replace all. So Studio's gone through, and as you can see here, looking down, it's replaced features with Funktionen. There's one exception to that, and that's happened because of the match whole word option here being selected. So match whole word means that the thing being replaced must stand on its own as a word on its own, not be part of another one like it is here in the German. So let me replace this bit here manually, and just digging into the segment, and I'm just going to type in the rest of that word. Okay, and then once we've done that, we can commit the changes up here that will accept all of those replace operations. So say yes. And should see that that will complete itself in a second. Okay, so there are no instances now. This empty screen here is telling me of target segments, target units featuring the word features. Okay. As if to prove the point again. All right, so I can clear that cell there and perform search to bring everything back again. Okay, just to show you another area of the functionality that we have available to us for maintaining TMs, I'm going to do a search and replace operation using a different technique. So the German has in it lots of units that contain this piece of text, Dialogfenster. Okay, let me just start. I'll run the search to show you that. Okay, and what I want to do is replace every instance of that word with another equivalent, Dialogfeld. Okay, so I'm going to do that. I could do it with the replace operation that I've just shown you, but there's another way to do it, so let me show you that too. I'm going to go to Batch Edit up here, and from Add, I'm going to choose Find and Replace Text. And I can type in my the thing I want to replace here. And what I want to replace it with, it's in the target. Let me use match case as well here. Click OK. When I click finish in a moment, that will replace make all of those replacements for me. So there's no yellow highlighting and no option to commit or not to commit. This is a more drastic solution, if you like, to the issue of how to search and replace for things. So there we go, we've edited 36 units. Okay, and the search runs itself again to show me that there are now no segments with that in the target. Let me clear it again, perform search. Okay, we're almost done with this first section now. Just a final thing to show you, you might be interested in how to, let's imagine for some reason that your translation memory was behaving slowly. Perhaps it built up over time and you were wanting to make sure that it was running as efficiently as possible. What you could do for that is select the TM in the list of TMs here. So obviously you'd need to have opened it in this view, in the translation memories view first. If you do that, it will appear in this list. So we'll go to settings. As you saw last time, I can see things like the number of units in the TM here. If I go to performance and tuning, I've got various options to kind of recompute the content a little bit, make it potentially more efficient. And I've heard this compared to re-indexing and recomputing. It says here there's currently no need to recompute the fuzzy index on this particular TM. But you know, if you did see a message there, then obviously it would be an indication of why the TM were perhaps slower than you were hoping it would be. So I've heard this compared to defragging a hard drive. If you're from that era, perhaps something more up to date would be something like descaling your coffee machine might be more appropriate for a modern audience, I suppose. Okay, I won't actually do any of that because it can take a little bit of time, so I'll cancel that now. Okay, so that's the first section done with. I'm going to take you back to the slides. I'll just summarize. So you can browse TMs, you can search for things in source or target very easily. If you want to work on segments that have a particular characteristic, you can create filters to match that characteristic and then do things. Display only those segments that match, for example, have fewer than five characters, say, as we saw in our first example, and then do things to those segments, like remove them. So that's decluttering your TM. You can edit your TM by replacing things in the segments. And that last thing that you saw there was how to make the TM a little bit more efficient, potentially. All right, so the next theme then is retrofit. So retrofit is a very useful feature. As translators, I think what most of us do is working in studio, we do our major checks in studio using the review features and so forth, and then we produce the target file in whatever format it is meant to be in, PowerPoint, Excel, HTML, Word, etc. And then we'll have a look through the target file in its native format. And then usually before we send it to the client, there'll be some small tweaks that we want to make to the way we've written it. And if you do that, you end up with a slightly different version in your, say, Word or PowerPoint file than you have in your bilingual file in Studio. And by the same token, your TM will not contain those final minor edits that you made in the Word or PowerPoint, etc. file. So obviously you can go through the individual segments in your bilingual file and make the same changes again, but that's duplicating the work and you might miss something. And then you've still got to update the translation memory as well. So Retrofit provides a neat solution to all of that. It's very useful, as I say. So let's take a look at it in action. Going back to Studio. So for this, I have a bilingual file, an SDLX lift that's been prepared to demonstrate this purpose. I'm going to open it for as though for translation, using the file translate single document command. Okay, and it's in my sample files Retrofit folder, and this is it here, the Retrofit sample document, and it's from a Word file there, as you can probably see from the file name. I'll just make sure that I've got the right translation memory with it. So I'll reselect the TM, which is in the same folder. Okay, it's a French to English translation. Let me open it up in the studio editor. Okay, so what I'm asking you to imagine then is that you've done this translation and you're ready to produce the target file from it. In this case, it's going to be a Word file. And then either you're going to review it in the Word file yourself, or perhaps it could go to a, if you're in a workflow with other people, it might be to send to an external reviewer, somebody who doesn't work with Studio, for them to make changes, any final amends to it. You can see that there's at least one thing wrong with it here. There's a misspelling of between there, and there are a couple of other things that we perhaps would like to amend as well. Confirm in writing should be confirmed in writing, for example. Okay, so what I'm going to do is make the target file from this by going to File and Save Target As, and I'll just mark it for review so that it's clear which file it is, and save. Okay, so let me go to that folder then now. And this here is the document that I've just produced in Word. I'm going to open it up in Word. So I'm asking you to imagine now that I'm making my own final check on the output document in Word before I send it to my client, or I'm an external reviewer that has received this file from a translator person in the same workflow as me. And what I'm going to do is I'm going to switch on track changes so that you can see what I'm doing. Just let me make Word a little bit smaller for some. My WebEx commands are getting in the way of the toolbar again, so I need to be able to see them. I'm just going to bring it down a little bit like that. So I use the, let me go to review so I can switch on track changes in Word. And you don't need to switch track changes on for this to work. I'm just putting it on to make it clearer for you watching this webinar. And obviously track changes is only available in Word anyway, so if you're doing this with a PowerPoint file or an Excel file, it doesn't apply. Okay, let's make a couple of changes then. So I'll say that the French had something that looked more like constitutes here. So let me change is to that, to constitute. And I'll correct the error on between. And I'll also go down to the bottom and make that change to confirm there, where it's, sorry, lost it. Okay, and then I'll save this file. Okay, so what I'd have to do now under other circumstances, go back into Studio. I'll close that down. go back into studio here, and I could potentially remember the things I've changed and make those changes from memory manually. But obviously, if there are lots of them, and that's going to be impossible, and it risks doing things differently anyway. So far better to do it automatically. All right, so I'm going to use a batch task for this, which is up here in the batch tasks list. So with the document still open, I choose batch tasks. And it asks me, first of all, to save the SDLX lif. So when you run any batch task, you have to save the SDLX lif first in order for it to work. So okay, that's okay, I'll save it. And it's asking me whether I want to overwrite the SDLX lif that's already there, which is okay, so I will do that. Okay, now if I go back to the batch tasks list, I can choose update from reviewed target file, retrofit. And that's going to take me into a wizard that will allow me to choose that file that I've just made the amendments in Word. You saw me make those three changes. And I'm going to pair that Word file with the amends in it with the original SDLX lift, the one that I've just closed down in Studio. So that's this one here. And here I'm going to right click and choose add specific review document. And then identify my reviewed file here, the Word file that I made the changes in from its name, and click open. That's all we need to do. So I'll click finish and close. And then would I like to reopen the SDLX lift? Yes. And there you can see that those changes that I made in the Word file have now been imported back into Studio. So I didn't have to do anything manually there, and I'm sure that they're all there. Okay, so the next thing that we need to do is accept or reject these changes. So let's do that. Okay, I'm going to go to the review tab here, and I'll choose to accept all of the changes in the document. Okay, that's fine. That leaves me with the amended segments having this rejected status. So one thing I could do would be to go and confirm those segments. It won't take me very long because Studio will skip any already confirmed segments when I press Control and Enter. So this is quite a good way to just have another look at what you've done. So I'm pressing Control and Enter here, confirming that segment, putting it into the memory, same on this segment, and same on the final segment there. So I now know that my my memory is up to date, and my SDLX lif is up to date, is consistent with the changes that those final changes that I made in the Word document. Another way to make sure that the content is in your translation memory is to go to back to the Home tab again in Batch Tasks, and the Batch Tasks Update Main Translation Memories is another way to ensure that the content of your SDLX lif has all been transferred to the TMs that you're using. So if I choose that option, Update Main Translation Memories, I've actually already confirmed the segment. So in this particular case, there's no real need to do this, but just to show you anyway, I click Next. And what this is saying here is that any segments with these statuses, which are the confirmed statuses in Studio, will be added to any translation memories that I have active for this task. So it also means that if at this stage I had another translation memory that I hadn't been using to do this translation, but which I wanted to populate with these translated segments, I could open it first in the project settings. I'll show you where that is in a moment. Let me just finish the task for now. There we go, that's completed. So that's updated the translation memory. So if I wanted to add this content to another TM that I haven't used yet, I could go to project settings here, and then I could select another translation memory, add it to this list. I'm not doing it here, but I'm sure you get the idea. Add it to this list. Okay, click OK, and then I could go back here and run my update main translation memories task again, and that will update that translation memory for me. So it's a great way to get content from your STLX lists into TMs at any time of your choosing. Okay, so that's the retrofit feature dealt with. Let me just show you the translation memory just to prove that those changes have been updated. So I'll go back to the translation memories view. I'll close this one. I don't need to close it. I'll open the TM that we use for this particular task, which is this one here in the retrofit folder. Okay, and then you can see, for example, confirmed in writing, constitutes, between, spelt correctly in that TM. Okay, so let's just do a quick recap on that section of the training, and then we'll go on to the next thing. So again, this is about making those minor corrections and changes in the native file format. In this case, we did it in Word, but it could just as well have been PowerPoint or Excel or any other file that Studio can deal with, any other file format that Studio can deal with, you can use Retrofit with. You simply import the reviewed target document back into Studio. You see them as track changes in Studio, no matter what format they came from, and no matter whether you use track changes to mark the changes up in the first place or not. And then you can update your TM by confirming the segments or by using the update main translation memories tool as well, provided that they have confirmed status. So an important point to note about the retrofit feature is that it's very much intended for those minor changes that you make at the last minute. It doesn't work if you make structural changes to your document. So if you start moving the sentences around, changing the order of the sentences, or putting in paragraph breaks, things like that, that change the structure of the document, it's not meant for those situations. It's meant for those spot edits that you make at the last minute, really. So as it says in the last point on the slide here, you should be making a small proportion of changes to your changing a small proportion of the content of your document for this to work. Okay, let's go on to the next section then, which is Perfect Match. So Perfect Match is a technology in Studio that is meant to make the handling of update projects much easier for you. What we mean by update projects, you can see that expression in the first item on the list here, is projects where you're working on some material that's been sent to you by your client. And then, well, in one situation at least, the client during the translation process changes the source files and sends you some updated source files to translate. So you've probably translated a great deal of the material in those changed source files, but you've still got to start translating new files again. And what you were looking for in that situation is to reuse, to leverage, as we say in translation memory terms, as much of the content that you've already translated when you work with those new files that have just come in from the client. So Perfect Match also works in a similar situation where you've got simply updated files. So for example, a product comes out, a new version of a product comes out every 6 months, and you receive some new instruction manuals to translate every 6 months, but they're relatively free of changes. There are only a few things updated each time. And PerfectMatch would be an excellent way of dealing with those files as well. Well, the great thing about it is that it removes the need to review content that's already been translated and approved in a previous version, so that you can just focus on the new material that you that's come in for you. A typical example of when you would use PerfectMatch is if you're working in a localization situation where very often files get changed during the translation process. The source files are updated by the developers, and you need to start working on slightly altered material. Okay, the thing that's different about perfect matching to the matches that you get from the TM otherwise, or that you get from the TM, because perfect match uses bilingual documents to examine the matches, is that the context sensitivity comes from looking at the actual files, the bilingual files that you've already translated, rather than looking at segments in the translation memory itself. And that's the big difference with Perfect Match. So if you have a whole document or a whole paragraph that has only one sentence, say, taking an extreme case, changed in it, Perfect Match will tell you that the context, that paragraph context, or the rest of the document context hasn't changed, and it will mark those unchanged segments as perfect matches, so that you know that you can safely look only at the changed segment and that you won't need to re-examine any of the surrounding content in any way, even to be on the safe side. So let's take a look at it then in practice. Okay, so I'm going to ask you to imagine that we have received from our client some new source files. We've already been working on this material for some time. We have a project that we've created to work on these files. But the client sent an updated version of the source file, so we need to deal with that situation. I'm going to create a new project to deal with the new source files that the client has sent me. Okay, so I'm going to new project here in the projects view. But the key thing is that I have already created a project for the files that the client had sent me in the first place, and I'm partway through translating them. So I want to use the project that I've been working on already as the basis for the new project for the updated source file. So here on Use Settings From, I'm going to browse to my folder. Okay, when I can find it. Sorry, wrong place. So I'm browsing to my sample files folder in Perfect Match. And in here, I've got a previous project. So this is the original project that I've been working on up to now. I need to go into it, change project templates here to show project files. And I can choose the previous project. And this will give me all of the same settings to work with, including the same translation memories and term bases and so forth. So let me click OK here. And say yes to overwrite the settings. And ignore that message. Okay, I'm going to call the project update project. And let's put it somewhere easy to access. So let's put it in the sample files. 04 perfect match is a good place. And let's call it update project. So this is my new project here. And select that folder. Sorry, I need to redo that. There we go. Okay. Okay, I can just check the location here, and there it is. Now, once I've done that, the source and target languages are modified to match the previous project based on those settings that I'm using. The only thing I need to change here is the project files, which are the files for translation. And these are the new files that the client has sent me, the modified source files. So I'll click Add Files here to add them. Okay, and in my folder, they're in here, the updated source files folder. And there are four web pages, so I'm going to select them all and click Open. And just select them there to make sure they're included in the project. Okay, so now I can click Next, and I can jump through these screens because I'm using the settings from the previous project. Everything is in place already, including the translation memory that I've been using to do all of these translations. Then just jump through, the term base will also be there. But when I get to the Perfect Match screen, what you see is that because I've used that previous project as the basis for this new project, Studio has looked for perfect matches based on the file names. So these here are the files in my, these are the files that I'm now translating, the new files that have been sent to me by the client, which are slightly amended versions of the ones I've already been working on. And three of the four have been perfect matched already with the bilingual file in my original project, so that Trados file with the source and target in it. Three of them have been matched because they had exactly the same name, as you can see looking down the list there of the bottom three files. The other one hasn't been. That's presumably because the file name was modified for some reason. But if I right click here and add previous document, I can go into my, just let me jump to my location. Okay, go into my sample files folder again. And in the previous project, I'll be able to find that SDLXLIF, the SDLXLIF that I've already worked on. It's in the target language folder, and it's called 01 Intro HTM. You can see why it wasn't automatically picked up as a partner for the new translatable file, because the name is slightly different. Okay, and that's all I need to do to set up the project. So now click Finish and watch it go through. Okay, so that all looks good, and I can close now to go to the project. So if I go to the files view, let me just change the view there. You'll see that these new files for translation have come in, and thanks to the perfect matching feature in the project creation process, that we're already 80+% of the way through the work on all of those files. I can have a look at the reports view as well to see what's happened during the process of creating the project. If I jump to the Apply Perfect Match report here at the bottom, I can see that in the four files there were 47 segments in total, and 43 have been transferred. That means 43 have been found from those SDLXLIFs in the previous project and put in as perfect matches for me. So I really have only got four segments, I'm hoping, there that I'll have to deal with in this update project. So let's open the files. We'll open them all at once. So I'm going to the files view, and I'm just going to select all four there in the list and hit the Enter key on my keyboard to open them all up together. Okay, these are just messages from the things that I was doing earlier on and can't be found in, but that's nothing to do with this project or demonstration. Okay, so you see that when the four files open up, just in case you've not come across this feature before, I've opened all four files at once. Studio creates a single merged SDLXLIF with them all in. And you can see that they are the file, the original files are divided up by these separators here. There you go, is another one. But having them all open at once means not only can I look down the content of all four at once, but I can also do things potentially like searching and replacing on terms or filtering the display on all of the on all of the four files at once. So let's just have a quick look at the PerfectMatch segments. PM, you can see obviously here, PerfectMatch. They're grayed out and they're locked. So we're obviously not meant to access them. And they've been pre-translated in that context-sensitive manner, looking at the whole document or whole paragraph context. So that even in a, when translating into a language like German, which has obviously has gender differences on the nouns and so forth, adjectives, that I might need to take account in case anything in the surrounding context had changed, that meant a change to a following gender, but nothing has changed to that extent. I can be assured of that by the perfect matching that's going on. So I don't need to edit those segments. I can just focus on the new stuff. One way in which I could do that, and again, this shows off the benefits of having the merged file open here, is to filter the display. So I'm going to the review tab to do this, and I'm going to choose segments that are unlocked, only segments that are unlocked, and those are the only new segments here. So I could quickly go and make the changes in my target cells like this, or if I prefer to, I'll reset the filter to display everything. I could just go down and make the changes in the normal way. Okay, so I would confirm that segment and go through the rest of the translation in the normal way. All right, so that's, now I hope that's a taste of perfect matching for you. Let's just go back to the slide and we'll summarize that section. So using the key really is that you're using a previous project, and the word previous means in many situations means the project that you're currently working on. When the updated files come in, you create a new project and use the settings from that first project to speed everything up in terms of creating that new project, making sure that you're using the same TM, et cetera, et cetera. And that takes those context-sensitive matches from the material that you've already translated by looking at the bilingual files in the project. The files are matched pretty much automatically, assuming the file names are the same. Or you have to do it manually if they're different. And any content that's been perfect matched based on that previous, in inverted commas, project will be locked and grayed out so that you know that you don't have to deal with it again. All right, let's take a look at the next section then, which is apps, useful apps for TMs. So part of the rationale for this section is to look at, to introduce you to the App Store in case you haven't come across it already. Sorry about that. Let's go to the App Store now. So you can find it through your browser easily enough. You can also get to it from Studio as well by going to the Welcome view. And down here you can see an option to go to the SDL app App Store. And that just opens the App Store in your browser. So you'll need to log into your account to get to it. I've already logged in. Just to speed things up, this is what it looks like when you come in. You can see a list of the kind of trending apps at the top. And there are ways to search in the App Store as well. And so if I type in translation memory here, you can see, I'm not sure what this button here is. Let's have a look at our list of product types. Let's search for translation memory then across the App Store. And that brings up a list of apps that are related to things to do with translation memory. So the apps in general are provide supplementary functionality, things that provide you with extra convenience in addition to the features already available in Studio. Most of them are free, so all you have to do is create an account, log into it, and then download the app. So, for example, with this one here, which is one of the apps that we're going to look at, you'll simply go and, once you've logged in, download it. It comes onto your machine in your downloads folder or wherever you download to. I've actually downloaded some of the apps already, the apps that we're going to use for this demonstration. I've already downloaded them, so let me just show you how they look. So these three are, well, at least these two here, are apps in the sense that they get incorporated into Studio and sit there in the background. I'll show you how you access them through Studio in a minute. The third one here is a separate application that sits outside Studio that does things related to translation memories. So to install an app, once you've downloaded it, you simply double click the file and it will run an installer for you. Most of them install extremely quickly. And sometimes you need to restart Studio for them to kick in. Okay, so let's take a look at a very simple one first then. And that's going to be this SDL Community TM Repair app. So I've already downloaded and installed these three apps or utilities. So in my welcome view, if I go to add-ins here, I can see these two here, these two icons represent the two of those three apps that we saw in my downloads folder just now. Okay, so if I click TM Repair here, this is a very simple app that checks whether there's anything wrong with your translation memories. So for example, if you were having an issue with one, to tell you the truth, I've never had a problem like this with any TM that I've used in Studio, but if you did have a problem with a TM that was something that was telling you it might be corrupt, then you could select the TM in this app. Let me just find the TM. So we've got a few TMs here to use for this purpose. Let's choose the repair one. And then I can run this integrity check on it. And that message there tells you there's nothing wrong with this TM, but if there was, you could repair it through here. So that could be, you know, could be a lifesaver in certain situations. Okay. The second app that we're going to look at then is slightly more meat on the bones, so to speak. It's this other one here, SDL TM Management. And if I open it up, I'll click it to open it. The things that it can do will be evident in a moment. So it can export TMs to Trados 2007 format. It's supposed to be 2007 rather than 17, which is the version of Travis before Studio that's still around for some people. But it can also, perhaps more usefully for us, remove duplicates, and it can reverse the index. I mean, that means change the language pair around, so an English to German TM can be made into a German to English TM, for example. Let's have a look at a couple of these things then. So remove duplicates. Let's take a TM. Let's add a TM to the list to form this operation on. Okay, so I'm going to add a TM that I've got for this purpose is the maintain one. I'm going to select that in the list. Bear with me a second. Okay, select that in list. It appears here. Then I go to my tasks list here. And I'm on remove duplicates. So this will remove the earlier duplicate. If there are duplicates, it will remove the earlier ones and leave only the latest, most recent of the alternatives that are in there. So it's more drastic than doing this in the studio editor, where you had a chance to decide between the two choices, between the segments, between the units that are in the TM, which you wanted to retain. With this, it does them all at once. You don't have any chance to intervene, so obviously bear that in mind. Let's perform the task. It takes a few seconds to do it. Actually taking longer than it did in practice, typically, but we're almost there. Okay, so there we go. And it says, tells me effectively how many duplicates it's removed by telling me how many TUs, how many translation units there are in the TM, which is this number here, compared to what there were before I ran this task. Okay, so that's one thing we can do with this app. Reverse the index. Okay, well, reverse the index. Let's have a look at, I'll come back to the app in a second. Let's just have a look at the TM before we reverse the index so that I can prove to you that this works. I go to the TM view again and open, and to the apps section. And this one is the maintain TM. So you'll see that it's, there you go, it's English to German translation memory. Go back to the app again then. So let's go back to the welcome view and add-ins and just reopen it. Okay, let me add the TM again. So it's this maintain TM, isn't it? Okay, and then back to the task. So reverse the index, okay? And it's asking me to specify where I want the TM with the languages the other way around to go. Okay, so let's browse to a folder that where we can put this. And let's put it in the same place as the other. We'll put it directly under apps then, okay? Maybe I'll make a new folder then, a reversed TM. Okay, reverse TM, and click OK, and that's where it's going there. Just double check that. And then all we need to do is perform the task. So that's going to, again, take a half a minute or so to do. If you're in the first training session last week, you'll have perhaps remember that we can also reverse the direction of the TMs temporarily by using the AnyTM feature when we open the translation memory. So in the page where you select translation memories to use, you click Use and then AnyTM, and that will allow you to use a TM that has the languages the opposite way around from the project you're working in, just for that project. It doesn't make any permanent changes to the TM, or it doesn't create a new TM, rather, with the languages reversed like this is doing here. Okay, so the task has successfully completed there. I could go to the folder, and there's the reverse TM in my reverse TM folder. Just to prove the point, I'll open it for you in the translation memories view. I'll need to close that first. Okay, so in the translation memories view, open, and there's my reverse TM. And it was English to German, and now it's German to English. Okay, so I'm going to show you one more app, or this is actually probably should be called a utility, because it doesn't go straight into Studio. Doesn't integrate into Studio. It sits as a separate application, and that is called SDLTM Convert. Oops, sorry, mistyped. SDLTM Convert, this app here, which I've, as I say, pre-installed. So I'm going to open this up, and that's what it looks like. It's a separate application. And what this does is, I think very usefully, potentially anyway, allows you to do different maintenance operations on the content of a translation memory, but using those features of the translation editor that are available within Studio. So things like checking for spelling, and then using the QA checker, the quality assurance checker, to look for things like extra spaces between words or mismatched numbers between source and target, things like that that you can't easily do in the translation memories view itself that's sitting behind here as I'm speaking now. All right, so I'm going to select a translation memory. And what we'll do with that translation memory is convert it into an XLIF, which is the bilingual format that we can use to work on the translation. So we can export the content of the TM into a file that we can open in the translation editor and then use the features of the translation editor before then re-importing it into the TM with the amendments that we've made. So let's click Browse here. Okay, and this time I'm going to use the Convert TM that's been given to me for the purpose of this demonstration. So I've selected and click Open. And what I want is to convert it into an XLIF. All right, so all I do is select the TM, choose the format I want to convert it to, that's XLIF, and then Run. And quickly says that it's processed 30 TUs and created an XLIF for me. All right, so I'm going to now open that XLIF, which, let me show you where that is first then. So the XLIF has been put in my apps folder, the same folder as the TM. And you can see here it is, XML localization. I hope you can see that's probably a little bit small, but XML localization file format. All right, so if I now select this to open it in Studio, I can do things on it in the translation editor in Studio. So let's do that. I'm going to go File, and then open and translate single document. And go to that sample files folder where the apps are. And remember, it's this one here with the XML localization interchange XLIF file format. Click open. This is left from my practice. So let me create a new project file for this. So. Okay, I don't actually need a translation memory for this, so I'm going to remove the TM. And let's just click OK to open it in the translation editor. So there it is. So what this is the content of our TM now made into an XLIF that we can look at in the editor view in Studio. All right, so shall we? Let's look at a couple of things that we could do to run the checks on it. So let's go to the project settings, and under verification, if you're familiar with the QA checker, a very useful feature of Studio, you'll have been here many times. I'm just going to disable the tag verification because that might give me more messages than I want to for this demonstration. And I'll go into the QA checker settings now, and I'll just set up a few checks. So let's do punctuation. Let's check that source and target end with the same punctuation. Okay, so if there's a full stop in the source, is there one at the end of the target segment? I'll check for multiple spaces as well. So is there more than one space between two words? And numbers, I'll just check for numbers to make sure that the numbers in the source have been replicated correctly in the target. Okay, so that's a very basic QA check set up there. And click OK. All right, so let's, on this XLIF file, let's run the spell check first of all, shall we? So let's go to review, and I'm going to check spelling up here. Or press F7 to do that. Okay, and it's found a spelling error here. Okay, so let me change that. And then another one there, I'll change that. That looks okay to me. These are just product names, so let's ignore all of these. I think that's okay. I think these are okay. These are just things that are not in the spell checker. Okay, let's click okay. So that's the spell check done. And then with those QA checker settings that I've just set up, I can run the verify option here. So let me just save the, I'm going to save this SDL XLIF first, okay, just to make sure I've got the bilingual file saved in Studio. Okay, it can go in my apps folder, I think that's okay. Save it. And let's run the QA checker. So that's going to be verify here on the review tab. Click verify. And that gives me some messages, potential errors in the file. So I'm going to double click on the first one in the list here. And that says to me that number is missing in the target segment or is not properly localized. So that comes from that number check that I asked the QA checker to make. Okay, with numbers, I need to intervene in the segment to make the change myself, but I can do it in this verification message details window. So I delete the zero there, okay, and I just click change now to move on to the next problem segment. And this one says extra blank spaces detected. It's looking here. I'll just prove to you that there are two spaces there. Just move around in that space. But with this, Studio can remove the space automatically for me. So I could change that there. Okay, and this is the same here. So if there's a suggestion, I can click change and have the change made automatically. Okay, this saying there's a space after the tag pair which has been removed. I could look at this. I probably want to ignore that one. So let me say, I'll ignore that issue. This is an extra blank space. So let's change that one. And then here we have an end punctuation difference detected. So the English, I hope you can see that, has a colon there, which the German doesn't. So I can put that in manually and then change. The same here. Change again. And then the same here. Okay. There aren't any more messages. That's great. Okay. So I can let me quickly save that. Now, so you'll notice that none of the segments are confirmed at the moment. And if I'm going to, what I want to do in the next step is to import the content of this bilingual file into that TM, the original TM, to overwrite the segments with the corrected ones, the ones I've corrected in here. So we'll need to confirm the segments for that, but it's a small file, so I can just go down and quickly confirm all the segments. Okay. There are a couple of error messages coming up here to do with tag pairs and so forth, but I'm not going to concern myself with those for the purpose of this demonstration. Okay, now. Save the SDLX lift to make sure that it's final. Okay, and then I'll close it down. So what I'm going to do next then is I'm going to import the corrected SDLX lift into my translation memory. Let me just remove that message there. Okay, so in the translation memories view, I need to open that translation memory, and if you remember, it was the convert one, this one here. Let's open it up in the TM view, so you can see that, for example, that number there, which I corrected to 25, as the source says, is still there at the moment. But let's import that SDLX lift into this TM and overwrite segments like this that have now been amended. So with the TM selected here on the left, we can right click and import, or we can choose import from up here and add files. Okay, and in my apps folder, there's my SDLX lift that I've made the corrections in just now. Click open for that. And then next, confirmation level. Okay, so segments that are confirmed essentially will be imported. What I want to make sure I do in this screen is select overwrite existing translation units if the target segments differ. So since I've corrected the target segments, I want the newer versions that I've just effectively created in the SDLX lift to be the ones that get imported and overwrite the ones like the 251 here that are already in there. So I'd select this option to overwrite existing and finish. And that's done. We'll close. The TM refreshes itself. And then down at the bottom now, you can see that number has been updated from 25, from 250 to 25, etc., as evidence that the TM has been updated. Okay, so we're coming to the end of the training session now. I'll just recap this little section for you. And try and fit in a few questions. So let me go back to the PowerPoint. Okay, so, well, there isn't a recap on this section, but I think the SDL App Store is a very useful place to visit if you're a studio user already and you haven't experimented with it. As I say, the apps tend to be free, and many of them are very useful. So take a look. Okay, final thing before I go to the questions, server-based TMs, group share. So when you're working in studio and you, anywhere that you get to, as an example, anywhere that you get to select a TM, like use here, there's always an option to choose server-based translation memory. And if the TM that you're using is somewhere on your hard drive or network, you will use file-based translation memory, but server-based translation memory sit on the in the cloud, I suppose you might say. And they have certain advantages over file-based translation memories. So if you're in a project management situation, you haven't explored group share yet. So group share is the surrounding technology that allows you to use server TMs. It's worth looking into because you can have several users working on the same TM at the same time from different locations, accessing it through the web to do translations, as I say, in different locations. Means you don't need to, you don't need to send TMs out to people individually by email, etc. Gives you lots of control over access. You can allocate access rights, different levels of access to different types of participant, and so forth. And also, it doesn't say this, I don't think, on the slide here, but server-based TMs can have more than one target language in the same TM. So for project managers, you can have a single TM that works for both, say, English to French, English to Spanish, English to Italian, etc., all in the same TM. Okay, so I'm going to wrap up the actual presentation part there. It doesn't leave me that much time to answer questions, but let me give it a try. I'm just going to open the chat. And see if I can pick out some questions that I can answer. I'm probably not going to be able to answer all of your questions, but if your question doesn't get an answer during the next 5 minutes or so, you can go to this area here on the STL website. So go to community.stl.com and choose the translation productivity button, and you should be able to get some help there with any questions that you have. Domini's asking me whether he has a PC and a laptop. If I install apps, do I have to install them separately on both, or will they appear on my second device once installed on the first? I'm afraid you have to install them separately, Domini. You have to install them separately, yeah. Will users need to have administrator rights to install apps in Trados, or can any user install them? I think that will depend on your individual setup. So it's difficult for me to comment on that, to be honest, because that's a more of a Windows issue than a studio issue. But if you're in an office environment, there's probably a chance that you won't be able to install them, I guess, yeah. Okay. Same question from question from Phil. What's the difference between a main TM and a project TM? And this is not easy to explain in a few seconds. A main translation memory are the translation memories that you create and use manually on your system in the usual way. So any TM that you create during the project creation process, or separately in the TM's view, is considered a main translation memory. A project translation memory, on the other hand, as you can imagine from the name, is really a project management tool. So it allows project managers to avoid, when they send material out to teams of translators, for example, to avoid sending those translators the whole of their translation memory. A project TM gets created in the background as a subset of the main translation memory by automatically selecting content that will be relevant. So Studio in the background, to create a project TM, looks at the content of the files for translation, compares those segments in the documents for translation to the main translation memories that you have active, and extracts the relevant content and puts it in a smaller TM, which we call a project TM. That allows project managers to protect their data and to ensure that translators are only getting the immediately relevant material. for their to work on during translation. Okay. Okay, retrofit. Retrofit. So a question from Jeff, does retrofit cover all file types, including XML? Yes. And if you have many files to update, can you do a large number at a time and in a few subfolders? I haven't tried it to that extent, Jeff, but my answer would be that it does work from the batch task is available from the project's view as well. So you can do it on the files in a project. Obviously, if you've got many files to update, you've got to ensure that the file names are matched for the retrofit process to work. But try it in the project's view would be my advice. So a question from Claire about using TM field values. It's something we've not gone into in this presentation, but so field values are effectively labels on the TM that once you've set the TM up with certain fields or labels, you can assign certain values to them during translation. So that means that a segment that you update in the studio editor, if set up in the right way, will automatically be given a particular value when it's added to the TM. So for example, if you're translating for a certain customer, you can create a customer field on the TM and ensure that translations done for that particular customer are all labeled with that particular customer's name. If you're doing translations for a different customer, you can equally well ensure that the units that go into the TM from translations done for that customer are labeled with that customer in the field customer. So then later on you can filter on those values in the TM view that we've been looking at today and potentially export material that belongs to a particular customer, for example. You'll also find that you can assign penalties. So if you're doing a translation for customer A and your TM has material in it that was created for customer B, you can get Studio to take a 1%, for example, off the matches that it gives you to flag up that the material wasn't originally translated for that particular customer. Would removing duplicates have a detrimental effect on perfect matching? This is from Petra. I don't think there's any particular relation, Petra, because perfect matching is based on not on the TMs, but on the previous bilingual files. That's the key feature, really, of perfect matching. So removing things from the TM won't affect perfect matching. Perfect matching looks at the bilingual documents that you've already been working on. So can TMs in Studio be, this is from Kim, I think, can TMs in Studio be converted for use in other software? You can export. So in the TMs view, if you open a TM and then click the export button, you can export to TMX format, translation memory exchange format, which is the format that was created precisely for that reason, for exchanging data between different applications. Okay, so final question about Anna, from Anna, about where her question is about where, if the example of dialogue failed, which I replaced in the TM, what if that is the plural form dialogue felder? Well, it's a good question, and you need to be very careful, obviously, when you're searching and replacing in the TM. So you need to experiment and make sure that you're not getting, you're not introducing errors into the TM by the changes that you're making. And that's, you know, that's the reason why I said that you should use a dummy TM or at least a replica TM until you know exactly what you're doing.